Tonight we have one roller coaster ride of new art. We have speaking John Thompson and Alison Craighead, Nina Pope and Karen Guthrie, and last but not least, Carey Young. So we're going to try and run through this as rapidly as possible because there's so much art to get through. We have a variable fast-forwarding through the art world. First up are John Thompson and Alison Craighead. John Thompson teaches at the Slade School of Art. He also teaches at the Ruskin School of Drawing and Painting, and also writes for Ice Storm magazine. They have shown in such diverse locations as the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis and as part of the Interstanding exhibition at Estonia, which is still on, so you can jump on a plane and go there after they've finished speaking, if you really feel up to it. And that's it. So, Alison, do you want to... Oh, of course, I've got Alison. Alison is a researcher at Westminster University. Is that right? Westminster University? Okay.
Okay, so I think we're just going to do a bit of show and tell, really. A few pieces of work that we've made over the last 2 or 3 years, and although, I mean, as it's error 404 not found, we'll be concentrating on things we've done on the internet, but we'll be also kind of trying to contextualize it with a little bit of gallery stuff as well, just to get kind of some sense of the kind of thing we've been up to over the last 3 years. So, in that we've only got half an hour, we'll just do it.
Okay. So, the first piece we're going to show is Trigger Happy. So, I'm just going to let it run for a bit, and then we'll talk a little bit about it.
Installation version of the piece we've made called Trigger Happy. So it's designed for gallery space. It's Space Invaders, and we've replaced the invaders with a text by Michel Foucault called What is the Author? And in the gallery, it's just a data projection onto a wall. There's a gamepad on a plinth, and you just play the game. And you get this kind of relationship between people watching and the actual player. And what tends to happen is the player's not reading the text, but the viewers can get an overview of what's going on. And of course, the passive viewers, if you want to call them that, actually start reading the text, and it kind of destroys itself from the backwards towards the beginning. So you get this kind of odd interplay between the player in the gallery and the passive viewer. And this is the internet version of Trigger Happy, which was actually how it was initially conceived to be online. So it's the same game, same text.
And what we've tended to do over the years is, for us really, when we first started working online, we decided that the most important thing was to just to treat it like any other site-specific piece of art that we would do. So anything that we do that has a gallery version as well is always tweaked for either occasion. So in this case, when you shoot a word up, let's give it a go, you then get the opportunity here to click on the word, which will then take you to a search engine results from that words, and I think it's at Yahoo, but that doesn't really matter. So the point really is that the reason we made it was really about the fact that you spend so much time with hyperlinks online and looking for information and in this pursuit of information, but actually you just end up clicking manically and never actually reading anything. So if you actually go in the pursuit of finding out some information about the moment in time or a family moment, then you actually have to lose the game in a sense. But we offer this little button that will take you back into the game.
So you've got a choice. You can either just click away without actually assimilating kind of the information you might find online, or you can actually leave the game environment and actually start getting some sort of return on your activity.
And did you mention about the fact of the 8 levels?
Oh, yeah, there's 9 levels to the game, and it takes you through the whole text about authorship. We chose that in an abridged manner, of course. We chose that text simply because it sort of questions the idea of authorship per se. But of course, Michel Foucault was so kind of didactic in the way he wrote it. You know, his presence was so felt in that text that we felt it was kind of probably a good thing to just shoot up and break apart.
And I think the one thing that's really noticeably missing from the online version is the soundtrack that we put in the gallery version. And they're found tunes or codes from the number stations, which are a part of the... Sorry, I keep looking away.
It's the upper shortwave band. They're these radio stations that just churn out numbers and no one really admits to them existing. And so there's a whole load of conspiracy theory about them. So... a lot of the aspect that was kind of like a Super Mario backing track kind of surrogate, but without acknowledged authorship. Should we go to Weightless?
Yes, so I think the next piece we're going to do is called Weightless, and this was made in conjunction with Channel, I think about a year ago, or maybe a little bit longer. So, whether you're coming into the piece from Explorer or Netscape, whichever browser you go in, you get a giant N or a giant E taken from the browser window. And for us, we were trying to do something that was about movement, it was about television, and also about net culture. And we were actually looking really for something that was the equivalent to a test card. And we felt this was our strongest icon so far.
I mean, we were interested in interface design as well, to an extent, in that we wanted to make the whole body of this work accessible from one location, so that you're not kind of following that, clicking through CDs, you know, going from one place to another, sort of maze idea.
Can we get the sound up a little bit? Is that all right? Can we get it up a bit more?
And what we used as the content was animated GIFs taken from people's homepages and transcripts from chat lines in sort of GeoCities predominantly. So some were teen chat lines, some were kind of 40s, meeting people, specialist programming chat lines, whatever. And in this way, to try and create a kind of almost televisual sensibility where the animated GIFs become like kind of little TV movies with the subtitling and the MIDI files, which again were all found and taken from existing sites, become like a kind of soundtrack. Should we just run it for a bit?
Yes. Should we get the sound up a little bit more? Because it's lovely. We want the full joy of it all. A lot of things that interest us here. It was actually like places like GeoCities have been very, very influential in how we approach the internet now. And anyone who's been there It's a very cheesy but extraordinary environment where you have a whole town or village set up and you choose where you're going to inhabit. And as part of that process, you're encouraged, or they encourage you to make a page. And by doing that, they set up huge libraries of animated GIFs and of MIDI files. And for us, we just became increasingly aware that this was the equivalent of IKEA, really. They were like, these things become iconic on people's pages. They stamp them onto their pages and they become very, very overbearing. So it was very interesting to actually strip it all down into the kind of the decorative features of people's web pages.
And to some extent, what we wanted to do was to still kind of keep them attached to some sense, the kind of emergent net culture from which they come, but also to put them in a relative vacuum, albeit still online. So that you kind of look at them in their own right, but also kind of knowing where they've come from. Every 3 minutes, a new MIDI file is loaded up, and there's about 60, and it just, which whatever the soundtrack is that you hear, is dependent on the minute of the hour when you actually visit the site.
I think the other thing that became apparent as well while we were making this was how quickly, I mean, it's very obvious, but how quickly the whole online culture changes. Because now when I'm looking at this, it looks quite dated. And actually, if you're going into a chat room now, you'll find that a lot of the language is now sprinkled with things that look like animated GIFs, so just single GIFs. And then people start incorporating it into the language, and it becomes like this hieroglyphics, which is incredibly interesting. But look, you know, and now, because I've been looking at more animated GIFs recently, they have changed. They become a lot more professional looking in the way of a greeting card, and quite a lot larger as well. Yeah, I think we're going to press on.
It's the sort of piece that kind of gathers weight the more you use it. It becomes quite nauseous, actually, after a while.
Which might surprise you. Okay, so what is the next piece we're going to show?
I think we're going to go to a video.
Yeah, so I think the next video we're going to show is a piece that we did for Pandemonium. And
it's a gallery work, so...
Yeah, it's a gallery work, but we find it quite... I think it really deals with a lot of the form that we're working with online.
So it's a user-led installation, so people actually kind of do something when they're in the space. The video is only about 3 minutes long, and we kind of are chatting on it, so it sort of explains itself. So I guess we just let the tape run. Particular piece, we've got all the speakers behind a wall. When you are just standing in the space, you hear just this kind of noise, this glossolalia kind of mass. And then using a stethoscope, you can pick out and get each single sound source and understand it.
It's just the idea of being able to pluck sounds out of the ether that excites us. That's it, really. Just the fact there's all this kind of information going over your head and mobile phones, and I don't know, I don't actually believe it's really there.
Accessing things from disparate geographical sources, but where you are, so you're physically somewhere and kind of virtually anywhere, you know. We tried to make something that is
a kind of analogue of what it might be like to be able to listen to the wall, if the wall could pick up whatever it is that goes through the space that you're in at any time.
One thing we found quite that we sort of hoped would happen but weren't sure is the more people that used the wall, the more kind of marks it became. So it kind of became this sort of self-creating map of the space, and over time the most listened to kind of nodes or conversations became the grubbiest marks on the wall, and it became easier and easier to read as a kind of surface when you're actually using it.
I think as well, the other thing that became very apparent with what we were doing is just with the advent of new technology in whatever form, you have to start reassessing your own kind of personal ethics on what actually is private space. And it's something that's very interesting. I think people just aren't aware how easy it is to listen into a mobile phone conversation, even unwittingly. Now scanners are sold virtually as toys to like young boys or young girls, and yet there isn't really anything done about it. And all you need really is a very good radio. Like we've got a clockwork radio at home, and I can actually tune into my neighbour's telephone conversations by accident when I'm looking for another station. And I think just with the increasing numbers of mobile phones, it becomes quite terrifying how much white noise there is out there.
And how personal people think the space is, when in fact it is about, it is as accessible as the internet.
And also, you know, people feel that email is a very personal communications device, or whatever we're going to call it, but it is so easy to break into, even accidentally.
If there's anything else we should say about it, I think in a way that the connection between what we've shown so far online and that particular gallery piece is that in most cases we've been taking existing data and manipulating it in some way, as opposed to loading up our sites or the gallery space with our own representations. And that's quite important to us, because we feel that because so much information is now kind of in our faces, it's a time of information overload. That we are privy to so much data that the sort of permutation of manipulating that amount of information becomes quite close to perhaps more traditional notions of representation. CNN?
Yeah.
So it's another web piece, and it's a simple intervention where we've added functionality to the CNN website if you visit it.
So it'll just take a wee while to download the CNN
site. CNN's a really big site, so it kind of does tend to. But all we've actually done is popped a little console up where you can choose an audio mood when you're actually browsing your news. So you could be jubilant or disaster or anything in between. And the idea is obviously that it highlights the kind of inherent distortions that exist in supposedly unbiased news coverage.
So what do you feel like today?
Upbeat.
Upbeat, okay. Just go for a little bit of a disaster, really, considering the headline. So, I mean, what I enjoy about this piece, and this is actually my favourite piece that we've made online, is the fact that you can. It's such a small device, but it has such a big change on the site for me, and I think that it also, you know, it's not so far out what could actually happen in a few months, considering this, their own CNN shop. I mean, I think that's quite sick, actually, but, you know, it would be an idea that I would come up with to do an intervention to put a CNN shot, but actually, you know, they've gone and done it.
Another thing we're thinking about when constructing this piece, apart from, again, it being a manipulation as opposed to a representation, was to use the MIDI files, which are kind of somewhat anodyne and mediated, which, of course, everything on the internet is very highly mediated in a way that is difficult for us as end users to authenticate or the validity of the information. So generally online, you know, it's up to us to decide whether something is valuable or truthful or whatever. And that, of course, extends and has always been the case anyway. And CNN is a sort of hybrid, it's a halfway in a way. It's an authoritative space, but it is in the mediated environment of the internet.
Okay, so actually we better move on because we've got another 5 minutes.
So it's going to show another videotape of... All right.
Oh, 10 minutes. Well, we've got 2 more pieces, so 5 minutes each. So the next piece we're going to do is actually... talking about CNN shopping, this is our own little shopping piece. So this is a piece that is a gallery piece, and it's very rough documentation. So it'll just give you an idea of the gallery work we've been making most recently. So we actually made this piece with the support of Take a Break magazine.
Not the colour bars, but...
No, we managed the colour bars by ourselves. And they actually allowed us into supermarket while they were doing one of their shopping riots, as they call them.
Take a break, call it a supermarket riot, but it's effectively a trolley dash. There were about 4 people who had 4 minutes to get as much stuff as they could in a Safeway in Loughton in Essex. And what we did is we took 3 aisles and we shot the 4 minutes action, and then we represented it in the gallery as a kind of fairly traditional video triptych. And it's synchronous, so that people moving from aisle to aisle is actually discernible when you're in the space. And we slowed it down quite a lot, and the sound as well with it, so that this kind of competition becomes again open to scrutiny. In a way, I suppose, you get a kind of almost anthropological gaze.
Yeah, it was actually very terrifying because the men went for fresh meat and the ladies went for toiletries. And it really was. The ladies went for washing powder and toiletries and the men went for chocolate, but mainly fresh meat.
But because it was slowed down so much, you get this rather ambivalent narrative kind of uncovering, where sometimes you look at one aisle and it looks maybe like it's a kind of robbery. If we come, as it kind of slowly pans to the middle, you'll see that a photographer for the magazine comes down and starts taking pictures. So you get this kind of odd interplay between what exactly is the story here.
Yeah, here she comes. And this is something we didn't expect at all. So we were really shocked when it was happening. That she was going to come in, and we were very upset about it at the time, but now she actually adds in a different element into the piece where you realise that something is very wrong and it's somehow very contrived, the whole situation.
So by the end of the 11 minutes, which is how long it takes with the slowed down version, this aisle is so trashed, it's unbelievable.
Yeah, a lot of what we were trying to do with this piece was actually just to manipulate, to utilise a lot of the traditions in video art, especially monumental video art. So we kind of looked very carefully at Bill Viola, Gary Hill's kind of majorly monumental pieces, and tried to use very similar tactics like slow-mo, black and white, taking the sound down. And that was something else that was quite interesting for us, just to carry on like trying to utilise the language of the gallery.
Thanks, that's probably plenty of video.
So the last piece we're going to show is called Browser Archaeology, and it's being shown in the Walker Arts Centre in Minneapolis, and it's going to be touring.
Which is a bit of a kind of funny thing. It's actually it's a thing called Artists Entertainment Network, which is a website, but it's attached to a gallery show that kind of does the rounds over the course of about 2 years. It's another game paradigm that we've used, but this time instead of Space Invaders, it's Breakout. And the gameplay starts normally. Oh, it's a bit fast, isn't it?
I think there's sound coming off this as well. Would it be possible to get that up?
No, I put the wrong one in.
You put the wrong... We've got a few versions. This is our offline version. We might be better doing this online, because obviously... Ooh.
Well, we'll let it run. It's anyway. You get the idea, if not a little rapidly. The normal gameplay starts, and after a certain amount of time, the browser itself starts to break up.
Very quickly, in this instance.
If you lose a life, right. You'll just bounce to a random URL. What we're actually trying to do at the moment is make it so that instead of being unearthing a site from the internet at large, you actually start to retrospect, and it unearths documents from your browser history. So as the gameplay unfolds, you'll become reminded of what you were looking at a week ago, 2 weeks ago, a month ago, whatever.
And you'll get your whole journey that you've had on your computer scrolling up on the screen. But that will be at the stage where actually you'll have got broken away. I'm just not winning on this. John's going to give it a go. The text behind is actually... It's actually the source code of the Netscape browser. So, I would use the pad. And what we're hoping for as well is the fact that very soon this browser that we've made is going to be outdated. So the whole thing is going to come more and more dated. So not only are you going to have your own personal history, but you're going to have a very old browser as well. And I can imagine by the end of, the 2 years, we'll have gone up quite a few browsers by then. I think the other thing we've had with the browser that dissolves or falls apart, we've made it so it's fully functional. So you can type in URLs and you can go to another site on it. And we've been beaten by our own game here. But this gives us an idea. This gives you an idea of where we're wanting to go on further. We're wanting to work more on working with a browser and actually trying to dismantle it more, or actually just look at more of the framing that the browser does to work. Yeah, so I think I know, being defeated by our own game just outsped us.
So hopefully that gives you a bit of an idea of the kind of thing that we're up to, and some of the things that actually interest us online.
Cool. Yeah. Next in our rapid fire is Nina Pope and Karen Guthrie. They both studied at Edinburgh Art School. Edinburgh Art School, how do you pronounce it? Nina has worked in various places like the Bach School of Architecture and the Royal College of Art. Karen is currently teaching at Birmingham University, I believe, and they have exhibited in such places as the ICA and Bury St Edmunds. Should we get you two up?
We normally have a kind of complex double act routine, but actually this evening we're just going to talk about one project each.
Do we have a slide thing?
Use that thing there. Can we have the slides first?
Okay, to
go forward there.
To give you a bit of a brief history, we've done about probably 4 or 5 large-scale collaborative projects together, starting in about 94, 95. And we originally started to work together really because of a kind of dissatisfaction, I suppose, with the sort of work we'd been making independently and the kind of, traditional media that we were kind of stuck in using. And it was at a time where technology wasn't really taught to fine art students in art schools in London. And we were pretty much self-taught and still are. And I think moving into works where technology had a higher profile was kind of a step that we might not have been able to make independently. So the trajectory of working collaboratively has kind of increased for lots of reasons, and now we do a lot of work in partnership. So the first, we're going to only talk about two projects because it tends to be quite difficult for us to explain what's going on in them, so it's kind of a bit easier if we just hone it right down to, I think, these two. So this one's called An Artist's Impression, and it is ongoing, and it was ongoing before this kind of resting point that you're looking at here for about 2 years. So this is an installation shot from the ICA, which some of you might recognize. It's the ground floor. And this was in October of last year. And what you're looking at is probably the last thing you expect to see when you think about what a digital artwork might look like. And that's kind of, that is deliberate. And I think the framework of the exhibition it was in, which was the Capgemini Digital Art Prize, gave people a certain expectation of this piece, which was kind of confounded on arrival, and resulting in sort of various responses, I think, from an audience who were expecting to be able to click on a mice when they came into the space and not sort of have to look at a thing. So what you're looking at really is a model, obviously, and it's about 8 meters by about 5 meters. And in the corner there is one of two sort of workshops furnished with kind of materials that you might make the island out of, but also with a small sort of iMac type, was it an iMac? Yeah, kind of Mac that was connected to the internet. So you kind of came into the space and had a feeling that those corners were private. I'm going to zoom right into a detail of the island at the moment and talk a bit about the origins of the project. When you came into the space in the ICA, I think you had some hunch that something was going on in those workshop corners. And essentially what you saw in them was Nina and I kind of building, looking at the internet every so often and building these little things that would go on the model. And we were obviously referring to something to build this model. So you kind of had a sort of live art, I suppose, experience, as well as being able to look at this large sculpture. And what we were actually looking at in that, on those internet connections, was a mush that we've built, which is very much the sort of other side of this project, which perhaps is less visible. And that was the side of the project that has been developing the longest. The island at the moment is simply kind of a resting point for the project at the moment, and it will change and develop, hopefully. And the mush itself was the thing that we kind of based that island on. So we were quite interested, I suppose, we have been interested throughout all our work, and in the piece that Nina's going to talk about as well. We've been quite interested in looking at, I suppose, the dark corners of technology and the kind of forgotten bits of it and the historic bits of it, I suppose, in a way as well. So, oh yeah, a mush stands for a multi-user shared hallucination. So I'll talk a bit about that, because what we're actually going to do is go into the mush that Nina and I have built, so you can sort of see what I mean by that. I realize it's a really sort of mind-bending thing to talk about without going into it, so we will do that. So we were looking at these kind of corners of technology, and one of the parts of the internet that is the least changed since its inception is mush text-based environments, I suppose you would say. A bit like chat spaces, but instead of simply having social interaction, there's a lot of emphasis on building. And when I say building, what I actually mean is text programming. Building up, as if you like, a kind of textual description of a space through scrolling text on a screen. You want to bring that up, actually?
Yeah, could you bring the computer?
Yeah. So Nina and I, about six, well, probably longer than that, about 9 months ago, actually built our own mush, and we're going to go sort of and log into that just so you can see what I mean by a text-based community, or environment, rather.
I'm on the village green.
She's on the village green. She's telling you. So you can see it's like a very impoverished interface, quite different from the model in the gallery. And Nina's wandering around in a village. So if any of you have been into these spaces, you'll know that on the whole they are quite heavily themed. You have a lot of kind of gaming ones based on Dungeons and Dragons, etc. and you have places where tiny sex occurs, that's quite a large sector of a market, and you have ones where very high-tech kind of discussions take place, and lots of them are very banal, and we were very interested in this imaginary compulsion that people have in these spaces. They're very heavily used, particularly in the States. I'm really interested in what was it about this really kind of cruddy, in a way, kind of interface that made people go back to these things and sort of use them almost like an interactive book. And as visual artists, this was particularly kind of confounding. I mean, why were people so interested in them? And were they visualizing the space as they moved through them? And if so, how? So we spent a lot of time actually communicating with people who used these mushes a great deal before we actually got to the point in the project that you're seeing now. And in doing so, we met somebody called Alan Schwartz, who's based in Chicago, who has become the lead program on our mush. Because Nina and I, despite trying to learn, have been very slow, and despite now running a mush, which is a sort of position of some power, are very technically dependent on other people to help us. So you might think you get to the point of running a mush, but what do you put in it? And bearing in mind what was the driving force for us was, what is this relationship between visual imagination and visual illustration, in a sense, and a kind of imaginary textual space? So we always had the idea it would be visualized, but what would we actually put in the text space in order to kind of kickstart the project? And alongside other sort of bits of work we've done, we decided to very much start from a kind of personal, almost sort of domestic position, where what we built on our mush space, so this is, when I say build, I mean text encoding, was two communities, sort of a village on one side and a coastal town on the other. And the coastal town is where you arrive on when you come to the island as a new visitor. So the coastal town was built on, based on my, I suppose, personal memory of where I used to live.
Yeah, that's good. Can we go back to the slides?
And the village was based on where Nina was brought up. So what we essentially did to kind of kickstart action on it was, if you can imagine, to kind of map one's own personal memory through a text description into this space. And that's simply done by sort of describing what you might see as you turn through various directions in that text space. And in that sense, the origins of the project are very, very personal. But as a user or game player, you can come on and actually navigate around those communities very, very freely, and hopefully begin to build. And that's what happened, just particularly during the ICA show, because there was a lot of kind of interest in the project. So we have these two communities which Nina and I essentially built the skeletons of, which are based on our memory, and which other users have come on and actually built onto.
How long are you talking about? You're right, I've got about another 3 or 4 minutes.
So what we're showing you here is one of the first settlements that it was very easy, if you were a new player, to come in and build in, and those are caravans. So to encourage new users to our space, we actually made some bits of coding very easy to use. And one of them was the caravans, where you could settle as a new player. And that's a detail of them there. This is a car park. You'll notice that it's lit up at the moment. And that's basically because in the mush, in the text space, the programming was such that it changes as we go into nighttime in British time. So when you wander around on the town centre, for example, if you're there at 5:30 p.m., you'll actually find that all the text descriptions you move around will change, and you'll be in a kind of depressing, wet coastal town at night with chip wrappers flying around, instead of being in this kind of nice utopian environment during the day. So that's Nina working away in the corner there, looking at the mush, I think. Yeah, the top of the middle of the island, rather, it lifts off in a kind of James Bond style, so you can access sort of inner elements of it. And we during the ICA, we were quite free about just lifting that up and kind of wandering around underneath it and leaving it there. And the electronics on the model are actually controlled from that space as well. One of the most complex programmed things on the mush is a train that you can actually take you over the space. And as you can imagine, building this on an island which was already quite developed was very tricky. And it caused a sort of huge scar on the island to evolve at the ICA. And this is Nina trying to patch up the damage. We never really got the train to work as well, which is kind of a bit of a bit of a problem, really. and that's kind of long shot down the coastal area where you could walk after logging on. So I want to just talk a bit about the community, the mush community, and why, in a set, why does the visualization of this mush look a bit like a model railway, which is something that is so, it seems so natural to us now that we are almost not aware of it. But a lot of people have questioned that, and why doesn't it look like an architectural model, for example? And I would go back to really the kind of experience we had doing the first sort of research for the project, which was about really getting to know the mush community and what it was about the mush that was kind of compelling to people. And it was very much the kind of exchange of information, the sort of currency of craft that you have within these spaces. If you can't technically program, you're like a nobody in them. So Nina and I kind of came into these environments, I guess, as complete novices and had to teach ourselves from scratch how to program and how to move around in them. And it was very, very, it made you feel quite small again, I think. It kind of disempowered you of the things that you normally have to hand as your abilities as an artist. And a lot of the work we do together sort of takes a position where we're already set back from what we perhaps are familiar with. And this is quite a good example of that. We wanted to sort of put the skills that we thought we had to one side and have to learn from scratch again how to actually do something. And it's an amateur, largely an amateur kind of culture mushing, and people do it simply for the love of it. So this was really compelling to us, and the way people actually helped us to build our mush as well was very, you know, really quite touching and a sort of interesting part of technology culture, I suppose, on the web. And so we're looking around for a kind of visualization equivalent of that culture in a way, because we knew that we wanted to explore what it would be like to interpret continuously what was going on in this real-time space. And so we looked around for a long time for visualization sort of mode until we came up with this one. And really, when we came up with it, it felt like the unit was kind of going into place, really, because it seemed so spot on in that the model railway world is exactly like the mush world. It's a community of people who learn through exchange, free exchange of techniques and sort of information and knowledge. It has an amateurish base. It also has a largely male base, which I'm not even going to go into there because I don't know what that means. But and it has a kind of shroddiness as well. I mean, there's a lot of parallels which I think made the project feel quite well combined when we found that way of visualizing the space. And for us also, it meant that we had to learn how to do it. We went to model railway clubs. We made a hash of parts of our island. We did things very badly, and we still are doing them very badly. We're still learning very visibly on this model as we worked at the ICA. And it was great because we'd have visitors who were just interested in the mush, for example, but also we'd have people who were just interested in seeing how we'd done a large-scale model railway layout. And that kind of notion of an audience which is diverse and quite complex is very interesting to us and something that we always think about when we're making work. This little slide here is just a detail of a building site that began to occur. Oh yeah, and this is a zoo built by a player who began to develop the Polar Parade, it was called. It doesn't have the polar bear on it there, but I actually did put a polar bear on that. So it was quite a demanding project to be involved in as a user. You had to learn how to play on the mush, and I think a lot of people who came to the ICA didn't realise that and thought it was a case of sending us a little email about what they wanted to see on the island, and it wasn't like that at all. And I think that's another sort of expectation, I think, of digital art exhibitions, is that they're easy to use and have a very kind of clickable interface. And this one sent a few people away, I think, quite disappointed because they couldn't just sit down at our computers and send us the plans for an airport or something like that.
These last slides are just showing you what it looked like right at the beginning of the ICA show and the changes by the end, although unfortunately due to the distance on the slide you can't really see them. There's more changes at the other end. Most people built in this kind of, in the town end of the island.
So this model's actually in storage at the moment, but as the mush is a sort of real-time ongoing space and in a sense has its own history, which is what's so interesting about working with it, this model will hopefully kind of come out of storage and be exhibited again and be changed. I should say that we very quickly after the ICA show we had a massive data crash, which is kind of a sort of risk of working this way, which looks like it was terminal. The way things are going, I think it was terminal. And it meant that actually all the new players and all the new buildings from the ICA were eradicated. So we're now in a position where it's kind of H.G. Wells' time machine conundrum. You've got to decide whether to destroy what has happened in the meantime and go back to a previous version, or actually just, I guess, kind of raise some of the island to the ground and start again. But it's quite kind of an interesting problem, this piece, because it goes on without our control, and it goes on when we're not, like, it's going on now, and we're not in control of it. And it's exactly like when you said about your game, being beaten by your own game, I very often feel like this about this project. I feel beaten by it, by the sort of enormity of it and the fact that it's happening, and it's at risk almost, you know, when we're not looking after it. And it's also got a very personal, imaginary sort of origin for Nina and I, so it's quite a strange piece in that way, because of the way it evolved very personally to do with our own memory. And to have it so publicly accessible on the web is quite a sort of odd situation.
Okay, so last summer, at the same time as working on that project, we were working on another piece, which was for the new Tate Bankside. The Tate obviously are opening this new fantastic branch, and in order to try and placate the community that live around that area, several kind of ham-fisted attempts at public art. So we were commissioned to make a piece which had art at its centre and took place in Borough Market, which some of you might have been to. I can see James is at the back of the audience, so you might want to leave. It might be too painful to relive some of this. So the piece that we came up with was called Broadcast, 29 Pilgrims, 29 Tales. And it played on the fact that Chaucer's pilgrims originally fictitiously left from the Tabard Inn in Southwark, which is very near the existing site of Borough Market. And so what Karen and I proposed for our piece was to advertise for 29 contemporary pilgrims who would go off on journeys of their own choosing for a 24-hour period to different locations, and would broadcast back at a given time their tale on the day, and that these tales would be webcast live on the day and also kind of presented in a sort of performance environment live in the market. So can I just flick to the computer for a sec? I'll just start by showing you the website.
The website, in fact, has only just been finished with real media encoded files, thanks to James at the back for that, of the actual tales from the day. So what you're seeing is actually quite a recently completed site, but during the event, there was a web space where you could actually go and browse all this.
So on the day, basically, you could see the schedule of the day with all the different pilgrims' names, and you could go to a page and access other details about them. But you could also see a live stream of the video that was happening in the market. And now, if you go into the pages, you can play either people's prologues or their actual tales. I'm just going to show you a bit of this because it's working so beautifully on the projector. Or is it?
It's really dodgy one.
Or is it?
No, that's the one that I get. Good from different one.
What's quite nice about these, because people presented their tales via telephone, the real media files work particularly well. There's something quite compelling about hearing somebody's voice over the telephone. So even though it's quite kind of crappy quality, it works quite well with the phone kind of style of the interviews. Although I've picked one now where she starts by not talking down the phone, of course.
7 years ago, I passed my drawing test, yeah? And I passed it after a hypnotherapy session. I'd already failed one. And I knew a hypnotherapist who told me that it completely failed me, that if I had a hypnotherapist session with him.
Okay. I just wanted to show you the website briefly so you could get a kind of feel for it, but I'm going to go back to the slides now because I actually find it very difficult to talk and operate the website at the same time. The project started by us interviewing all the people who applied to be pilgrims. And this is one of them in our studio. And I just thought I'd run through some of the different people that we chose in the end. This is Philippa Venn Brown, who's a Australian Chaucer scholar who worked as a nurse in a cancer ward. And she went to Canterbury to see some medieval tombs she'd been researching. She's a fantastically buoyant and very knowledgeable person about Chaucer, which is very helpful to us. This is Richard Guest, who's a person who worked at the Tate, who projected the silhouette of his nose onto a map of London and walked around the outline of it on his pilgrimage. This is Barbara, our oldest pilgrim at 69, who went to visit a tall ship in Southampton that she'd helped to do some building on, having had a kind of cathartic experience going on a trip on a tall ship in her retirement. This is Jerome Fletcher, who rowed down the Thames on a Venetian boat and told a very kind of complex interwoven story which related to death, his father, all kinds of different things. It's a good tale. This is Steve Ireland, who told the van driver's tale. He went back to his former childhood home in Corringham in Essex. And I think, I mean, his tale represented a journey that many people make, in some regarding it as a pilgrimage, some others not. But sort of, I think maybe probably people in the audience all kind of thought about what it would mean for them to go back to somewhere they'd lived previously. This is Bankside Beauty, our biggest team of pilgrims, who were from the local beauty parlour in Southwark. Karen went to have her legs waxed and made the fatal mistake of actually telling them what we were doing when they said, "What else are you doing today?" And they signed up for the project. They went to Hampton Court based on a tarot reading they'd done. And I'm just going to play you one of the prologues. For each person, we made a short video portrait of them based on their interview, which kind of talked a little bit about them, a little bit about what they were going to do on the day. So if you, in the day, on the market, if you heard some music and saw a prologue playing, you knew another tale was going to come on. Could you play the next video?
You've got a long shot of the market.
Yeah. If any of you saw My Peace Safe Bet, you might recognise the person who's this pilgrim. Can you turn the sound up?
We should say that actually not only did we develop the tale and the website in collaboration with each pilgrim, we also developed this music with them, and the composers, Tim and Matthew Alden, worked with each pilgrim to actually evolve a bit of music that they felt conveyed what they wanted to say. So it was a bit like collaborating with 29 people throughout.
Turn the sound up a little bit.
So this is him getting ready to be interviewed about why he should be a pilgrim, so he's a little bit nervous, shifting around in his chair. But...
My name is Ed Nicholson. I'm public relations manager for Ladbrokes during the daytime and nighttime. My pilgrimage is entitled The Punter's Tale. It's all about travelling up to Aintree Racecourse, Liverpool, to see Red Rum's grave. Red Rum, the famous racehorse from the 70s who won 3 Grand Nationals and was placed twice. No other horse has done that. And really, on the way, I'll be telling, hopefully interesting tales, of my connection with Red Rum, how he's touched my life. One thing that is probably sacred to me is my love of horse racing. And everybody, even if they don't like horse racing, have heard of Red Rum. All throughout my life, up to when he died, or even now, I suppose, I've been connected to Red Rum in some way. Most kids, I don't know, playing football, you know, putting a pin up to their favourite pop star. I mean, I had a jigsaw of Red Rum, and I put it together, I glued it together and stuck it on the wall. I used to write magazines. Even when I got to be about 24, 25, my gran would phone up and say,
"Some of the most compelling reading I've had in a long time."
So I'd actually get on the computer and just do them and send them up to her. When Red Rum was going to run in his final Grand National in 1978, I went up and stayed with my relations in North Wales to go with my dad to watch the race. And the eve of the night, he was pulled out of the race. And it was a devastating blow to me because I wanted to go and see him run. And so I never saw him actually run live. So, you know, that was always a discomfort to me.
Thanks. Can we go back to the slides? So I just kind of romped through a description of what it was like on the day. This is us looking slightly haggard in the market on the day. Basically, there was a kind of small stage area where we would be standing kind of presenting in quite a kind of... made obvious reference to TV, but there was also this kind of big technology area which was all kind of revealed to the audience, and the idea was that people would be able to walk around and kind of see all the stuff that was going on. And behind the desk, that you could see the feeds coming in from all the different cameras, and you could see the stuff going off onto the big screen on the left, but also out onto the web as part to be webcast, essentially. And then most of the pilgrims told their tales remotely, just via a phone link, and you could hear their voice coming out in the market, and we would be chatting to them. And then we had visuals and stuff prepared for them, which would come up on the big screen. And then a few of them, this is Gwen, who did the shopper's tale, basically went on this walk back to somewhere she'd lived previously and collected objects in her trolley. She came back and actually presented her tale live in the market. So it was a kind of mixture of people coming in remotely for their slots and coming in live. This is Jerome, who I was saying went on the boat trip doing his live. And then towards the end of the day, it got more and more chaotic as pilgrims were arriving back whilst others were still telling their tales. This is Phil Jones, who did the scientist's tale, where he went to Bognor Regis, the site where the astronauts and cosmonauts shook hands during the 1970s kind of space race program. He actually worked for the British Antarctic Survey, but he decided he'd like to go to Bognor for his pilgrimage. And on one side of the, on the other side of the market, to where all the sort of tech stuff was happening, there was a kind of cafe area where you could look at the website and find out other information about the pilgrims. But also there were these cases with lots of objects that the pilgrims had given us over the weeks kind of running up to the project. And then in the evening, once the pilgrims all came back, the market became a kind of slightly more private space, and we had this feast, as happens in the Canterbury Tales, with just us and the 29 pilgrims. So I'm just going to finish by playing a tiny bit of video from what it actually kind of looked like on the day, and then we'll stop after that and Kerry can come on. Okay, so our next pilgrim coming back is going to be Gwen, the shopper, and I'd quite like to flip over to a live radio phone link with her to see how far away she is and whether I should walk out the market to go and meet her. Hint, cameras. You're just dialing her up.
You can see the sheer professionalism of the day.
And the other thing I'd quite like to point out is, if anyone can follow me, over in the cases here is the fantastically elaborate display that Gwen's done of where she's going on her route, on her pilgrimage. So, starting from our studio in Borough Market here, with her shopping trolley, these are the badges that she's taking with her to give to people as tokens on her pilgrimage. That's Gwen. This is, I believe, the house that she used to live in as a child, and I can only guess that that must be her. And you can see her routes marked by all these red dots leading down to destination 21 Farnaby Road, which is where she's walked there and back. Okay, apparently we've got her on the line, so I just want to come over and check where she is and whether I can come out the market to meet her. Hello, Gwen, it's Nina.
Oh, hi, Nina. I'm just outside. I'm trying to cross a rather busy road at the moment, so I'm going to take
okay.
my time.
I'm going to make my way out to try and meet you then, and hopefully right. the cameras will follow us.
Okay, right. I'm sort of making my way over.
Okay. And Lizzie's...
I'm fairly unmissable with my trolley.
Lizzie's ready on set with the box to put the objects on.
This so, particular
Tim,
bit kind of
music,
sums up
please.
What we hoped would happen a lot more on the day, the kind of mad chaos
right.
mix
so,
of
I'm assuming
live
you're coming
TV,
in the main entrance,
performance,
because otherwise we're going
yes.
to kind of annoy the
so
camera
you,
crew.
So if you're walking through the market, you might be quite confused about what it was you'd come into.
There's some confused looking people looking at the sign, is all I can see at the moment.
Yeah. I'm just coming up to the entrance. It's got the banner with broadcast over it.
Okay,
yeah,
that's all right.
Yeah, here I am.
Here you are, on your phone. I think we could put your phone off now. Hi, okay. Together, fantastic, well done. Amazing. Trainers still looking very, very new.
Okay, that's great, thanks.
I'm blistered though. Oh dear, plenty of blistered.
We'll try on to the daytime television there. Moving swiftly onwards, Kerry Young graduated with an MA in photography from the Royal College of Art in 1997. Since then, she's done very little photography and worked in a variety of media, including video, performance, and sculpture. She showed recently at the ICA, the Photographers Gallery, and then Chisendale Gallery. And her work is now on as part of the Continuum exhibition at the CCA in Glasgow. So, Kerry, if you'd like to come up.
Hi. Could I have the slides up, please? Right. I've got to say before I kind of kick off that the general pretext for this evening's talk is very much about digital art. I've got to say I don't see myself in any sense as a digital artist. I'm not sure what a digital artist is, but I'm really not comfortable with that term for myself. I thought recently, well, what medium do I actually use the most? What tool is most important to me? And the only thing I could really think of that consistently was a pattern was a mobile phone, but there's no term for mobile phone artists, so I'd probably use the term communications as my broad interest. I'm very interested in technology, but I don't like working with it. And in fact, one of my long-term interests has been around how do you understand technology? You know, it's something that people feel is quite alien to them, and perhaps something they feel kind of concerned about, particularly in the way it's kind of, well, I look at that as the fault of the people that kind of decide on the names, the terminology, the packaging of it, which is very, very particular. And in the West, certainly, it's very much around speed rather than perhaps notions of community or you know, more human aspects. And of course, most people, I think, generally do think of technology as dehumanizing and have a worry about that. So my work for the last few years has been very much about trying to find spaces for a more human approach to technology. And not to say that in a kind of whimsical fashion, but very much about human emotions, loss, failure, being outside, etc., etc. So the first set of work I want to show you is the work I showed as my graduation show at the Royal College, a set of photographs which I called Wired, named after the magazine, but very much not about the success of the digital era, the gloss and the glitter of the networks, very much about the kind of what's outside to that, what can we connect to technology that feels more familiar and perhaps helps us to understand this huge, great information era that you know, is upon us. So what I did was photographed something that I noticed first outside my front door, which is these little wires, which are the fiber optic cables that are being laid, that were being laid then, but which carry the data on its route around the network, and in fact would form, slightly dated term now, but the information superhighway. And when you look at it, they're tiny, but of course they're carrying this huge cultural weight. That huge weight, especially now, you know, entering the new millennium, all the news and kind of importance connected to the internet, I think cannot now be ignored or rejected. So, you know, I'm very interested in the fact that this is the internet, but we're looking at it in a very, very small and local scale. And these wires are actually severed from the network. So in one sense, they're kind of rejects, they're failures, they're the things that didn't make it, but they're nevertheless within our human physical domain. Could I have the next slide, please? Oh, sorry, it's me, isn't it? So what I actually, could somebody focus that a little bit?
Focus
on this. Yeah. Oh, DIY. Is it? Not when you're a photographer. Okay. Right. What I actually did was approach the making of these images by thinking about the theory that surrounds technology, and for anyone that's sort of looked into this, there's an awful lot of it. There's an awful lot of kind of metaphors that get attached to technology from a sort of philosophical perspective. So thinking about technology in the body, you know, reams and reams has been written about that. So I wanted to approach this whole body of work by thinking about those ways of interpreting technology, but using photography to actually actualize that and make it literal, to poke those connections a bit, make them too literal and see whether they fitted. So here, you know, thinking about technology in the body, does that feel appropriate? If technology is photographed as if it was some kind of body part, does that seem appropriate? Does it seem disgusting, or can we, as humans, relate to something that also looks like flesh and blood? Perhaps this is I would think of this as a little digital community. These works were actually shown at a size which is probably quite similar to how they're projected now. So the works are actually quite physical in themselves, and they're mounted onto aluminium, so they've got a kind of definite physical presence. So with all of these, it's more about what associations we'd pin onto these images, rather than what these wires are actually, or what they're doing. You know, this happens to be wires spilling out of some kind of plastic cabling, but I don't think that's very interesting. I think it's more interesting in terms of the associations that are thrown up here. And of course, you realize that you're making that projection of meaning, and I think then it becomes more transparent that we do project things onto technology, perhaps what we want or what we're worried about. A theme running through my work as a whole is that technology, you know, cannot be seen as necessarily the new. You know, it's an ancient drive within humans to create tools. These happen to be our perhaps most important contemporary tools, although many might argue with that. But, you know, I'm much more interested in the kind of the ongoing links that can be made between what we would consider new technology and older ways of thinking. You know, and also, I think, you know, as a comment, I'd ask to everyone that might consider themselves digital artists or working with this media, how do you make work about technology that doesn't date with the tools that you make it on? I'm not, you know, I'm for me, that was a question that made me not want to make work on the internet, but to use other media to approach the same issues, the same world, if you like. So thinking about technology and the city, and it's quite interesting hearing about geocities from John and Alison. You know, technology in the city is something that's been written about a huge amount. It's a connection in space, and then the city being a metaphor that's connected with the internet very, very often. I think I'll shut up now, because it's much more about what people read into these than what I think they're about. That's upside down. I've got to say these, I'm very embarrassed to say, upside down. Right. This is another project. And this is actually a sculpture project. This is the next project I did after leaving college. I do tend to work across many different media, as I'm sure I've mentioned several times now. And I also tend to work collaboratively with other people and to make people and multiplications of thought about the same thing part of the work. And with this, I wanted to work with computer hackers. I've collaborated with science fiction writers in the past to make kind of joint visual artworks, people like William Gibson and J.G. Ballard. With this, I wanted to work with computer hackers because I think they're really fascinating in terms of their intense knowledge about computer networks. In some senses, they're the architects of the internet. They've been extremely important in designing and creating the tools and also creating the background freedom, if you like, freedom of information elements of the internet. They're extremely important, I believe. And also, of course, if you read the media, they're cyber terrorists. So they're people that have got international government figures rather worried about the safety of their data and their networks. So they're kind of contentious body of people, but also rather mysterious. And I wanted to look at them in terms of their knowledge about technology and perhaps to bring that out a bit. So in order to kind of provoke some kind of debate around technology and what it is and what we think about it. So what I actually asked them to do was to work in a medium which is completely untechnological and about as physical as you could try and be. So that was actually clay. So what you're seeing here are actually some tools which may be familiar from primary school. These are tools for making shapes and designs on clay. Now this is documentation. So these are just kind of snapshots of what people actually made. I have to point out, and this is actually work in progress, so this is not how it would be shown in a gallery, but I just wanted to show you the work as it exists at the moment. There's a possibility it's going to be shown this year for the first time, and I'm very interested in having a kind of live element to this work, which I'll talk about in a minute. But basically what I asked people to do was to take a lump of clay, all hackers that made these pieces, and to form a shape or a small sculpture that would express their interpretation, their experience of technology and networks. And I also asked them to write their digital address or name. So most people gave me an email address. And they also many people chose to write a small statement about their object. And this is a technique that I picked up from two different sources. Firstly, it's something used by art therapists. It's a Jungian technique, which is supposedly able to bypass linear thought patterns. So it's a way of accessing areas of the brain that are often suppressed. And it's something that's used in therapy to look at kind of areas that may be blocked because of some kind of painful association. But the idea is very much to access a more kind of creative, a more perhaps open area that can, the object that's created can lead into a much richer debate than if somebody just was able to describe an experience it using words. The other pathway, the other area this is used in is in marketing. A focus group uses this technique to describe new products. So say you have a new tin of beans, instead of people describing their thoughts about this product, what they'd actually do is be given a piece of clay each and then asked to make a shape that would express what they thought about that product. And then they can use that shape to write about themselves, and also the marketing analyst would then use those for further analysis. And the idea is you get much richer data from doing that. So what the shapes that they made, I mean, there's about 70 of them at the moment. I think they're really quite illuminating about the internet. You know, you've got anything from the kind of what you might associate with technology, representations of networks, of kind of infinite loops, to kind of rather abstract shapes. And for me, it's about the journey back to the sort of technological roots of this, from something that sort of looks quite childish, perhaps, because we've all done something like this at school, to something which is extremely sophisticated, which is their knowledge about technology, which of course is something that is increasingly impacting everybody. When I show this, I plan to get analysts to actually write about these objects and give me readings, so there'll be kind of multiple interpretations. Yeah, I see these objects as technological, and I like that kind of the sort of tension between them as technology and knowledge, and their kind of physicality. And perhaps you could see them as kind of runes or ways of predicting the future. Right, this is something quite different now. I want to talk about my life a bit now. I actually work as an IT consultant, and I put this slide in because I wanted to kind of explain to you a bit about that. I work for a big multinational IT company, and I took that job partly not just because of the money, but also because I was very interested in kind of potentially creating some kind of collaboration between myself and some IT consultants. It's a bit of a crazy idea, and I certainly haven't managed to make that happen. But what has happened to me en route is that I've got completely fascinated in the culture of this company, not only from an IT perspective, but very much from the position of what is a corporation, and what is a system in that sense, and what's the language of that world. And I put this slide in to show you that they have invested in me as an artist, which I think is really nice. But also that they did manage to put this fire extinguisher under my work, which irritated me no end. But I wanted to very much stress to you that my work is not about trying to be anti-corporate. I'm not taking an anti-corporate position, but I'm very much interested in the notion of being an insider or an outsider to that world, because I believe that we're all actually insiders to it, even though it seems like some secret society to those that don't form part of that sphere. So this is a sneak preview into work that I'm doing at the moment. I've been taking photographs at clients' events, a kind of hospitality, corporate hospitality events, asking other people to take photographs. I was very much about kind of merging with that world. There's quite a few in this series, but I just put a few in. Right. This is another piece of work. which is actually an internet project, but because I'm so deeply untechnological, these slides are actually slides of a printout. That's how much I don't like the internet. So what I actually did was got some money. I was given some money by a public arts funding body as a commission to make an internet project. So what I did was invested it on the stock market. So here's a still from one of the web pages with the check that was given to me. This is public money. What I actually did was invested it in two companies that are listed on the American stock exchanges under two different symbols. One is Art and one is Life. So that's not their name, their company names, but that's their symbol, their name that they trade under on the stock exchange. Every company, every corporation has a symbol like this. So many artists are investigating the gap between art and life. And this is my interpretation of that theme. So what the work actually does is track the progress of the shares, and art and life kind of compete against each other on a daily basis. Oh dear. Shall I go back? Is it? Oh, right, okay. Thought I put the other ones in there. Okay, what happens in this is basically, if anybody wants the URL, I can give it to them at the end. The whole site is designed around taking different views of the portfolio that I created. So you can check how they're doing on a daily basis. You can look at analyst reports on the companies and their interpretations of art and interpretations of life. You can look at the debts that are owed by the companies. Very much about buying into corporations, but still managing to create art. So I want to show you a video next. So if you could switch the slides off. This is now performance work that I did last spring. Before you play it, could I just say something? What this actually is something, it's a new venture for me, which is performance, but I'm using my own job now as a kind of inspiration for my practice. So, I actually at work teach clients about technology, and as part of that, I'm performing every day, basically. I'm standing in front of a bunch of people and talking. And I got really interested in the notion of being in that environment, in the corporate world, and being a performer. And I happened to go past Speaker's Corner on the coach one day and saw everyone on ladders standing up in front of a crowd, preaching, if you like, about politics and religion and things like that. And I thought, my God, that's exactly what I do. But, I'm doing it in a corporate environment. So I thought, well, why don't I go to Speaker's Corner and deliver some kind of corporate speech? And would people feel offended by that? Because there's so much kind of anti-corporate feeling around. So would people take to that? Because, after all, Speaker's Corner is very much about free speech. So this is now a piece about communications and about public space and about what people feel is appropriate in terms of democracy. And it's also, I guess, about what's appropriate for artists to do. So if you could play the tape. And switch the sound up, please. If you could switch it right up.
Thank you. Hello, my name's Carey Young, and I'd like to talk to some of you about presentation skills. I'd like to teach you about presentation skills. If you'd like to gather round, I can teach you about presentation skills. Hello, My name is Kerry Young, and I'd like to teach you about presentation skills today. We're in a place which is very famous for public speaking, but you probably would feel a bit nervous about getting up here until I've given you these skills which you need to know. And public speaking, you can see it as a hobby. It's something that happens here on Sundays, but you could also use it in business. If you're in business, you'll be very used to making presentations as a matter of course. Presentation skills can be very useful in terms of just giving you confidence right across your whole life. If you're a shy person or a self-conscious person, having these skills will really help you get over those problems. And also you'll learn how to convince people about anything, any of your ideas, just to convince them about you as a person. And I personally believe that everyone can learn these skills and everyone can be a public speaker. There's really no mystique to it. You just need some practice and these basic skills. Now just imagine that somebody's asked you to give a presentation. It could be a speech, or perhaps you've got a job interview coming up and you're going to be speaking to a panel and they need to hear about you and your background. We're talking about the same skills here. It's the same kind of things that you need. And really, there's just three basic factors that you need to think about. There's a lot of mystique around public speaking. There's been a lot written about it over the years, but really I think you only need to remember three things. The first and most important thing is to be very aware of who your audience is. You need to actually do some homework about who you're going to be talking to, and you need to also think about their own professional background. Do they already understand the subject matter that you're talking about? Do they perhaps know more than you or the same level, or are they completely new to it, and do you need to adjust your language to suit them? Each of these needs a different approach, but if you are even just aware of your audience and who they are, you will be doing much better than most public speakers who really don't seem to care very much. You also need to think about how big your audience is going to be. If it's just 5 people, you can be very informal, but above about 20 people, what we call crowd dynamics, crowd psychology, starts to happen. And that's where people just naturally sense they're part of a group and they would want to be treated more formally. If you don't do that as a speaker, you'll get a very bad feeling between you and the crowd. You need to be very aware of who is in your audience. Do people know each other or are they strangers? Are they colleagues? Is there a good group dynamic? Is the boss in the audience? Do they need to be careful about what they laugh at? Do you have to be a bit more rigid about what jokes you say, or can you relax? And also you need to think about the age of your audience, the gender split, the ethnic split, all these things you'd need to be very sensitive to so you don't offend anybody. Also, you need to think very much when you're giving a presentation about what your audience actually wants to hear. They've probably come to actually hear you say something, and at the very least you're taking up their time, so you do need to give them something. You must find out what they need to know, what they want to know, and make sure at the very least that you've covered that. To become a really good public speaker, you need to go beyond understanding. You need to go beyond just getting people to hear what you're saying to a level where you're actually able to change what they think, change their perceptions. Once you can do that, you'll know you're quite a powerful speaker. You need to also be able to give your audience something useful. You are giving them a gift, you're giving them information. It's got to be useful to them. Now, the next factor that you really should be aware of is the content of your presentation. What is your message? You need just one. You can boil any good speech down to one basic message, which has been used as the spine throughout all the information as a way of organising it and bringing it into something that everybody can understand simply. And you need to remember that whether you're the world expert on your topic or not, you cannot hope to boil down all your expertise into one short presentation. So don't even bother trying. It's going to just confuse people. And you need to be very aware of the last factor that I'm going to talk about now, which is how you come across as a speaker. You need to be very aware of the way your total communication. Only 7% of your communication actually comes from what you say. The rest of it is from your body language and how you actually look, and also the tone of your voice. So you need to actually practice in front of a mirror and also in front of friends who are quite willing to be critical of you and be honest. And you need to know how a changed behaviour actually feels so you can be different and notice. That's all you need to know. That's three factors. That's the basic points. Who's your audience? What do they want to know? What is your message? And how do you come across as a speaker? And once you know those things, you will be a good public speaker and you'll have those skills. So you can see how easy it actually is. Now, has anybody got any questions?
You can switch the tape off, please. Thanks, that's it.
Well, I think we've got enough time for just a couple of questions, really. I think everyone's quite keen to sort of start moving on. Yes. Beautifully timed. What a beautifully timed lecture we've just done. Has anyone got any questions? Anyone at the back? What happened to What Was a Mud? And I had a great question prepared and I've forgotten what it was now. Any offers from the audience at all? What happened to all the missing slides? Well, if there's nothing, absolutely nothing? Nope, okay, fine. Well, I'd like to thank all our speakers. Thank you for some very interesting and entertaining and very provocative bits of work there, and I love them all. And thank you to the speakers. Thank the audience for turning up, and I'm very subconscious now of the whole process of giving a presentation, so I will stop there. Right. Thanks very much.
Perfectly. I'm going to put everything in my cupboard. Is that off mine?
Yeah.
Is that off? Yes, it is.